I'll come to the disclosures. Here are my disclosures. All right, so just start with the little history of PYP imaging. So in late 70s and early 80s, there were some case reports about PYP being positive for amyloid. And then early 80s, there's one case series came out and said it was a useless test for amyloid, and people stopped using it. Then in 2002, Pugli and group from Germany published an 8-patient case series and said that DPD was very useful in identifying patients who were having more heart failure symptoms and more arrhythmias. Then 2005, Perugini and group from Italy published a study with 25 patients and said DPD was an excellent agent for diagnosing amyloidosis, and they said it was 100% sensitive and 100% specific for TTR amyloidosis. They had only 15 patients of TTR and 10 were AL amyloidosis. So after that, we wrote to FDA, asked them if we could use DPD over here, and they said it's not approved, we can't use it. So we looked at the chemical structures. The one which was closest to DPD was PYP. And then we looked at some historical perspectives, saw some case reports from late 70s and early 80s. And we decided to use PYP as a diagnostic imaging agent for diagnosing amyloid. But the studies which are done in Europe are done as a whole body scan. So if you look at the top one, is the whole body scan. And the study takes about 3.5 hours to do. And the patient is under the camera for over 60 minutes. These are all older patients. And in US, most of the cameras which are here in United States are in outpatient facilities. And they're all read by cardiologists. So we thought if we are going to do the whole body imaging, that would be a problem for US. So we developed this protocol, which is done within an hour. And we just do the chest imaging, so it can be read by cardiologist. So bottom one is the protocol which we developed, which is done in about an hour. And then we looked at multiple things. We looked at multiple doses, compared that. We looked at counts, started from 750,000 counts to 2 million counts, and found out the study quality was as good with 2 million counts as with 750,000 counts. You had a question last after the last talk was that how long does it take if you're positive? It takes 3 minutes. And if you're negative, it takes 6 minutes of acquisition time to get 750,000 counts. So the things which we really wanted with this protocol was that once you do the image, the things which you have to look for, first thing is image quality. If you have no uptick in the sternum and the ribs, you can't read the study because this is a bone-seeking tracer. It's not in the bones, it's not a good study. If it's in ribs and sternum, it's an excellent study. If it's only in the sternum, it's a good study. Then after looking at the image quality, you look at what the uptick looks like. Is it a focal uptick or a diffuse uptick? With amyloid, you get diffuse uptick. Focal uptick is not amyloidosis. Focal uptick could be an old MI, could be a rib fracture there. So you have to be careful with that. After that, you're going to look at the visual score. And then after that visual score, you're going to look at the heart to contralateral ratio. And then in not all the patients, some of the patients you would need SPECT. I'll talk about that which patients would need SPECT. And then looking for incidental findings. So for image quality, this top image, we said we couldn't read because there was no real uptick in the ribs. And we repeated the scan after 2-3 days and the patient had clear cut image. So I think there was something wrong with the PYP. And the second, if you look at the bottom row, you see the patients who have breast implants, you can't do visual score, you can't do heart to contralateral ratio on those patients. So on those patients, you're going to rely mostly on the SPECT transaxial image and see if the myocardial uptick is, if the myocardial uptick is less than the ribs or greater than the ribs. do a visual score on that. So, and for visual score, if you look at the left images right over here, are ALs. So first thing we look at is if the uptick is there on the heart or not. So in this case, there is no uptick in the heart. So, and the best view to look at these patients is in the lateral view, because that separates the sternum from the heart, and you look at the intercostal region and see if it's equal, greater, or less uptick in the myocardium, and give the visual score on the lateral view. You do not need an LAO view for this. So if you are, your camera has 90 degree collimation, so you just need one view. 3 minutes, it will give you interior and lateral. You don't need to get another LAO view, because LAO view is not used for visual scoring or other. So, and then for your, this one, if you can see here, so visual score is 3, greater than ribs. Whenever you see an image like that with some central clearing and uptick in the myocardium, that is positive for TTR. It's not blood pool, right? We have done over 1,000 patients, and we looked at our data, and 40% of our patients which we have done have a score of 0, 30% have a score of 3, and then 30% are score of 1 and 2. The ones who have a score of 0 and 3, none of those patients had blood pool. So the blood pool problem is with a score of 1 and 2. So those 30% patients would need SPECT to make sure you rule out blood pool. And out of those 30% who have a score of 1 and 2, 56% have blood pool. In those patients, you would need a repeat scan to see if blood pool clears up or not. So score of 0, score of 3. And just a few examples. Again, reading it in the lateral view. We always look at the anterior, but read it in the lateral view. Visual score is 0. Here, visual score is 1, is less than ribs. Visual score equal to ribs. Visual score greater than ribs. So with 3. So 3 greater than ribs, 2 equal to ribs, 1 less than ribs, 0 no uptick. Then visual score was very subjective. So we wanted to come up with a method with which we can have some quantitative data. So we developed this method of heart to contralateral ratio, in which the uptick, which is in the myocardium. So in this case, you can see the left image is AL. When there is no uptick in the myocardium, you're done. You don't need a SPECT for a visual score of 0. You won't see anything. So why to keep the patient under the camera for that long? So in this case, you can draw the region. The region is drawn only on the LV. Do not include RV on that, because then you're going to end up including sternum. So only on the LV, and then mirror image, copy that to the contralateral side, away from the RV, above the diaphragm. Biggest problem is when people are below the diaphragm, you're going to get your heart to contralateral ratio, which won't be right. And then you'll say, okay, I was calling it negative or positive, and the biopsy showed different because it was not drawn right. So it's very important to draw these right. And you're going to look at the mean counts per pixel, not the max counts, not the total counts. The most sensitive in this is mean counts per pixel. So if you look at on the right side, this was our first study which we published, and we looked at 45 patients, and we had the sensitivity was 97% for diagnosing TTR, specificity was 100%. The sensitivity was low because of this one outlier, and that was a patient with rare mutation, which was 59 leucine. All those patients with these mutations are always negative. So all full-length amyloid fiber are all negative with TTR. So just a few examples of heart to contralateral ratio for you guys. So here you can see if you are, I don't think you can see it properly, but if you are towards the sternum, that's going to raise your heart to contralateral ratio because you're getting counts from the sternum. Over here, if you are again below the diaphragm, that's going to also raise your counts because you're basically correcting it for the abdomen, not for the contralateral side. Same thing over here. If you go towards this, you're including RV. That's going to be a problem. Or if you're outside the chest wall, that's going to be a problem. So very important when you're drawing heart to contralateral that you draw it right. So SPECT. SPECT is helpful, especially in two conditions. One is blood pool, to rule out blood pool, which I said that you'll have about 30% of your patients who are in one and two who would require that. And also, it quantifies the degree of myocardial uptake by comparison to rib uptake, especially in patients whose quality is not good. You can look at the transaxial slice and see. So this is what you're going to look at, the transaxial slices, grade of zero, grade of one, less than ribs, grade of two, equal to ribs, grade of three, greater than ribs. This is one example, a patient which we did. If you look at the visual score over here, you're going to call it probably one. Right? Heart to contralateral ratio, when we drew it over here, came up to 1.5. And when you do your SPECT, it's all blood pool. We waited 2 hours. This one became zero. Heart to contralateral came down to 1.21, and blood pool cleared up. So important with a score of one and two to do SPECT on those patients. And example of wild type, when the SPECT is positive, it's just like a perfusion study. And then AL negative, nothing on the SPECT. So you're going to see that. So reasons for false negative PYP are early. Reasons for false positive are early ATTR cardiac amyloidosis. And reasons for false positive are AL cardiac amyloid. So it's always, always very important to do serum and urine on all the patients. It should be combined. This PYP should be combined with a blood test to rule out AL. And the other one is blood pool. So these are some rare things. There's patients on plaque O'Neill can be positive. And these, if you have a focal uptake, that's usually not cardiac amyloidosis. Reasons for false negative PYP are early ATTR cardiac amyloidosis, the most common reason, or these full-length fibrils, and then delayed imaging. If you delay too long, then your visual score would be less because there'll be more bone uptake, less myocardial uptake. And if you're going to use a 3 hour, you can't use a cutoff of 1.5. For 3 hour, the cutoff is 1.3 for heart to contralateral. So this is just an example for incidental finding at the end. So this patient had uptake in the rib over here. And when you draw heart to contralateral, it comes in there. So that's sometimes a problem, especially in older patients. You'll see rib fractures. So in those patients, what you do is you draw a smaller region on the contralateral side first, away from the fracture, and then mirror image copy it on the heart and get your heart to contralateral with that. And then this patient, if you have this bone uptake, which is suspicious for any malignancy, you send them for bone scan. This patient, we send the bone scan, which showed just a fracture in the bone. Do I have time or not?
Yes.
6 minutes, okay. So I'll just quickly go over some cases with you guys. So this was an 81-year-old African-American male with the V122I mutation and had a history of prostate cancer. So what do you think the visual score is in this one? So it looks like three, right? So visual score is three. This was a 74-year-old male, again, ATTR with neuropathy, had a 64 leucine, and TTE showed EF of 45%, and also left ventricular wall thickness was 14 millimeter. So what's the visual score on this?
Zero.
Now this one was biopsy positive TTR cardiac amyloid, right? Again, because this is a full length fibril, which is 64 leucine or 59 lysine. They're always negative. If you have patients who have a family history who are carriers for this, do not do this test on those patients. Those would be negative. So this is a 75-year-old male cyclist, had spinal stenosis, had bilateral carpal tunnel syndrome, HFpEF. So what's the visual score? So two or three, right? Three probably. And heart to contralateral was 1.69. So what I'll do is just do two more and then I'll take questions. So 78-year-old male, ATTR, V122I. So visual score is 3 and heart to contralateral was 1.90. All right, so last one and then I can take questions. 61-year-old male, hypertensive, non-ischemic cardiomyopathy. So no uptick, right? Visual score of 0. Heart to contralateral was 1.05. I'll stop here and take your questions.
Thank you. As people move into the mic, one quick clarification question. You, your current workflow, you only acquire at the second set of images at 3 hours if the visual score is 2 or 3?
No.
One or two, I mean?
1 or 2. Okay. Right. And we acquire it at 2 hours. We don't wait 3. So we do first hour, and if it's we think it's 1 and 2, just to rule out blood pool, we'll repeat the scan in 2 hours.
And you do spec routinely?
Only on 1 and 2. Not on 0 or 3.
Thank you, Dr. Bokhari. We've had some cases at our institution where the semi-quantitative visual score is 2 or 3, but despite due diligence, making sure the regions of the interest are drawn appropriately, the quantitative score by HCL is less than 1.5 or vice versa, grade 1 uptake with a semi-quantitative score that's greater than 1.5, similar to that case that you showed the first time. How do you approach those cases where there's disagreement between the semi-quantitative and quantitative scores?
That's an excellent question. So you'll have few patients where there'll be disagreements. So you rely on SPECT on those patients also. So get the SPECT on those patients, see if the myocardial uptake is there. Because sometimes what happens is your heart to contralateral is affected because of blood pool. So I would rely mostly on SPECT. And another thing which is very important, if your clinical suspicion is high, even if the scans are negative, I would send those patients for biopsy. So if you think the clinical suspicion is high, you're getting a score of 1, visual score, heart to contralateral of 1.4, 1.3, I would send those patients for biopsy.
Thank you.
Dr. Bokhari, when your region of interest is smaller because of extracardiac uptake, like in that one case, when you put it over the heart and the heart is suggestive of a horseshoe, do you tend to move that region of interest over the myocardium, not the cavity?
Exactly. Okay. We put it on the myocardium, away from the cavity.
Is there any role to scan, TYCB scan, if you have positive light chains in serum and urine studies already and you suspect AL?
So we PYP? Always, so this again, a good question. We always combine these, both serum and urine, and PYP scan, right? Some, you can argue and say, okay, what if I do serum and urine and they're negative for monoclonal, or they're positive for monoclonal and positive or positive for light chain. Mm-hmm. Do you still need PYP? No, right? But we do everyone combined so that we don't miss that. Okay. Because the problem is AL is a medical emergency. Mm-hmm. Right. So we just don't want anyone to miss this. In the past, what we did was when we started doing it, there were a lot of community cardiologists who were sending us patients. 25% of the patients, we went back and looked at it, 25% of the patient never had serum and urine tested. So we decided, okay, it's important that everyone gets both tests. It's not an expensive test, easy test to do.
Thank you.
We have a couple of questions that have come in over the app. Do you need to amend your license, your nuclear lab license?
Sorry?
Do you need to amend your nuclear lab license?
We have not. I don't know if we have to or not. But so just one more thing I just wanted to let you guys know that PYP is still not approved for amyloid imaging by FDA. So we use it, and we have not had any problem with reimbursement. Again, the reimbursement is not that high. You know, it's, the average is about $500, and in Canada, it's about $60. You could do the whole study.
No.
Your ability, so if you're doing planar, the billing code is 78800. If you're doing SPECT, it's 78803.
That's in the practice points, by the way, those codes, if you didn't write them down. One more quick question. What post-processing software do you use? Can this be done on radiology packs, or do you need 4DM NVM?
It can be done on any software. It's pretty simple.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next.